Fran Lab.
Yeah, so, I think this is the last time I'm gonna do the C64 shirt, because I did it once before in the 1.0 lab. And honestly, I think after this campaign, there will be enough of these shirts in the world that there will never have to be any more. But also, I'm gonna start doing regular merch campaigns with different things, because I've got different designs I want to make, and I want to make all kinds of different things out of them, practical things and other things, and art objects. And one of the things I got to do for fundraising for the lab for this year and, well, forever, is to do campaigns, fundraising campaigns and merch campaigns, because Patreon isn't going to cut it anymore. You know, for a while there, Patreon was paying for everything. It's not doing it anymore. So this is Patreon. So on the far right there is where we are right now. And on the left there, where that little tag is, December 2020, that's where we last were as far as like the funding. So it's been, yeah, 3+ years since we were at this point. The last big spike there, that's October 2022, when we had the last big push. And that actually was a big deal, because I had a lot of new support in that fund drive. Actually, this shot here, this is just the swag for the top Team Fran Lab members, the new top Team Fran Lab members. Just in that one weekend campaign for Patreon in October 2022. And that was the last time that we had something like that. So ever since then, it's just been kind of trickling off. Yeah, okay, so this is the last 12 months. At the current rate of drop, by the end of next year, there's really not gonna be much in the way of Patreon at all. And I don't know if it's Patreon, I don't know if it's the platform, although I know a lot of people are, you know, still increasing Patreon. The number of people on Patreon is increased, but it's just my channel. I used to get like a steady like increase, just, you know, replace supporters, but that just hasn't been happening. People have been leaving, and the channel's sort of the same way. It used to be that I would get like 1,500 new subscribers every month. It didn't matter, you know, as long as I made content, new subscribers. But the numbers have really been like zero, like net zero. Like, I haven't had like any new subscribers in months. It's kind of weird. It's just like the whole platform is just it's just cooling off. So to continue to pay the bills and stuff, I'm going to have to be doing these merch campaigns to fill in the blanks. The AdSense too, the ad money. Since YouTube made the changes, I've stuck to the absolute minimum. I've been turning off the mid-roll ads and making all the ads skippable, and YouTube keeps screaming at me saying, you know, if you didn't make these ads skippable, you know, if you add more ads, you know, if you add mid-roll ads, you'll make more. It's like, yeah, I know I make more money, but that's, you're kind of ruining YouTube with the freaking ads. So yeah, we're gonna do merch campaigns. And big news, of course, was Starship. Yeah, Starship 3. It's like Plan 9 from Outer Space. We're all playing. Yeah, Starship 3 is very impressive. I know people like to bust chops about, LOL, can't even put rocket into space. SpaceX is such a joke, they can't even go to space. It's like, yeah, you obviously follow SpaceX. They put more rockets into space than any other entity on Earth, and have put more mass into space than any other entity on Earth and all that. So it's like, yeah, total failure. The most impressive part of the whole thing was the fact that they were able to get video from the ship when it was hitting the ionosphere and starting to heat up and get plasma. Now, obviously, they were using Starlink for that, which, again, Starlink is, those satellites are above, they're at a higher orbit, so Starlink antennas were, I guess maybe they had directional antennas, but they obviously were transmitting away from the ionization, like not towards Earth, but towards space, and the Starlink satellites were picking up that transmission even through the ionization. It's pretty impressive. I don't think that's ever been done before. I know they tried it with the shuttle. Did they have live? Were they able to do live broadcast from the shuttle though? I know they tried doing satellite link with reentry with the shuttle, but I don't know if they've actually ever seen live plasma reentry before. But yeah, it's the Starship. It was the largest object ever put into space. You know, people really were like, meh. But it's like a warship-sized object hurtled into space. Pretty freaking amazing. Not as impressive as the Saturn V, though. It just doesn't... Running on methyl ox, the show is just not as dramatic as running on kerosene, the RP-1. The Saturn V, the F-1s, it was just such an impressive and very dirty display of exhaust. But, you know, running the really highly efficient, closed-cycle methyl ox engines that, you know, have a really clean little tail flame, it's like, it doesn't look impressive. Even though it's bigger than the Saturn V, even though it's heavier than the Saturn V, it's can't understate it. How impressive it was. And Richard Truly died, astronaut and administrator. Yeah, 86. Had a good run. Was he the first one to wear glasses in space? I wonder. He might have been. Yeah, I think he might have been the first person to wear glasses in space, because he was like on, it was like, oh, third flight. Okay, for third Challenger flight. So early on, he might have been the first, I don't know, but definitely rocking the NASA glasses, totally. In space. Richard Truly, a good run, very good run. Oh, this is interesting. This is in the Science Times. I don't necessarily dig the title, but they called it "A Smartphone Dials In from the 11th Century." No, I don't think so. It's weird to call it. It's not a smartphone. It's a slide rule. You know. So if the Antikythera mechanism is a mechanical astrological calculator, this would be the astrological slide rule. Can see it there. You know, it's got one little overlay there that goes over a disk. Yep. And so as you rotate it, changes the alignment with an analog guide that's etched into the plate. Although, you know, I was looking at this picture and it's like, it looks like it was cast in place. It doesn't look like it's like scratched in. It looks like, I'm wondering if something like this might have been mass-produced in a way where they would create a mold with all of the intricate, like, inlays that would be etched in or inlaid into the back plate and, you know, on a ceramic mold, and then you pour the brass into it, and then when it cools you can pop it out and then fill it again, and, you know, just like casting a coin or something. I wonder if they had a way of doing that, of like mass producing something like this, rather than hand etching all of the little lines and stuff for the various transits and things like this. It would have been really cool to think that maybe they were mass producing objects like this back in the 11th century. But yeah, it's a little circular slide rule is what it is. Oh, I thought that was cool. Yeah, smartphone, jeez. Everything's got to be a smartphone, because if you don't call it a phone, no one's going to know what you're talking about. How did the world exist before phones? You know, people made those things without phones. Can you believe people remembered stuff without phones? Do you remember people used to read stuff without phones? How did people live without phones? This is an interesting review of a book, The Girls Who Code Break, The Enigma Girls, How 10 Teenagers Broke Ciphers, Kept Secrets, and Helped Win World War II. this is very interesting. I don't have the book. I read the review of the book, and it's really about these teenagers who got drafted in, to Bletchley Park. Everyone knows about Turing's computer and that area of the code breaking of Bletchley Park, but most of the work they did there was just women and girls intercepting coded transmissions, translating Morse code into letters, translating German into English, English into German, intercepts and stuff like that. But the interesting thing about the book is that these girls were drafted, they're all teenagers, like 13, 14 years old, they're like, you know, in what we would call high school. It said here, the one just got a mysterious letter. "You are to report to Station X at Bletchley Park," the letter said. "That is all you need to know." Imagine getting a letter like that in wartime. That if you're a 13-year-old girl who scored well in math and you get a letter from the government saying, "Report to Bletchley Park, this is all you need to know." And so these teenagers, they would pack up suitcases and just get on a train, and they didn't know how long they would be gone or what the hell they were going to be doing. They just went, and basically it goes on to say that it was basically like summer camp, because these kids, you know, they're teenagers and they're supposed to be breaking codes and fighting the Nazis, but they're really just, you know, being teenagers and trying to make the most of being away at coding camp. But yeah, it's an interesting book. I'm going to check it out. If you're not in the U.S., you might not have heard about this, but lead found in cinnamon, and the FDA urges a recall. This was weeks ago. Children in the United States were being hospitalized with acute lead poisoning, and they traced it all back to applesauce that had been tainted with lead, and it led to this whole thing of how did lead get into applesauce, and it turns out it came because of the cinnamon, in air quotes, that they put in the applesauce. And if you know anything about cinnamon, you know that cinnamon these days is really not cinnamon at all. To get maximum profit, that this applesauce company was buying cinnamon from a company that was having the cinnamon processed in Ecuador, and in the process of processing the cinnamon, they were adding lead to the cinnamon to give it a redder color and to increase its weight. Because if you're being paid by the ton in cinnamon, then yeah, they add lead to it, and it really increases the profitability. It's just weird that in many parts of the world, adding lead and mercury and cadmium and stuff to food and merchandise, it's like, yeah, you know, we eat lead all the time. You know? Kids love the lead because it's sweet. They eat lots of it. You know, it's like, yeah, there's still parts of the world where people are totally fine with that. But it led to this article about how, surprise, surprise, the FDA actually doesn't check everything that comes into the United States because it's all based on trust. The FDA allows manufacturers to trust companies to certify that, well, this product is unadulterated coming from country X, and we certify that it's unadulterated. Here it is. Here's a cargo ship full of it. And then company in the US says, oh, you see here, it says certified unadulterated. No reason to look here. Let's just put this on the shelves and sell it. And that's really the system. And when stuff like this happens, you see the fragility in a system based on trust, where profit motive just makes everyone into a crook. It makes you wonder how much stuff you actually eat that you're not supposed to eat, you know. You trust that the level of mercury in the fish that you're eating is supposed to be what it says on the package. Is it? Well, they put that number there because somebody in some company in some country says that it's that, and don't bother checking it, you know. So yes, it's scary, scary stuff. You never know what you're eating or putting in your face. Yes, red lead. And this is the thing. It's like, this would not have been in the news 300 years ago when everybody realized that, oh, red lead, it's yummy. It brightens up, has a bright red color. You put it in your food, it makes it sweet and red, and it's jolly. It's like Christmas time. So yeah, lead and cadmium and mercury were put into all kinds of stuff hundreds of years ago before they knew that it would kill you. Lead in the cinnamon, but like I said, you know, cinnamon, you really shouldn't even buy it anyway in the supermarket because it's not even cinnamon. You can look it up online about why cinnamon isn't even cinnamon anymore. The Romans used lead for pipes for piping water into the city. Not just the Romans, the Americans. In fact, lead pipes in America is still a big deal. In fact, if you are in the United States, if you're anywhere in the rural part of the United States, especially in the Midwest, you know all about the fact that hundreds of thousands of feet of lead pipe have been removed from places like in Michigan. There's a huge issue in in the state of Michigan because lead pipes were used for water pipes in the 40s, 50s, 60s for the same reason that in the 20th century it was believed that lead was healthy. And there was a huge industry of lead in the United States that pushed lead. Lead paint would be sanitary, that lead paint lasted longer than any other kind of paint, which honestly it did. It was good stuff for weathering and stuff, but it's also toxic. And water pipes were made of lead. And so there's a huge push now in the United States to try to remove all of the lead pipes throughout the United States and trade them out for plastic pipes or copper pipes. And it's like a decades long thing in the US. So not confined just to the Romans. If you're in the United States, depending on where you live, there could be like a 50-50 chance that the water that's coming into your house is coming through lead pipes. It's like that big of a thing. Yeah. And sweetener, yes. It's so sweet, makes everything taste better. Makes your water taste sweeter. Thank you, lead. And of course, mercury. I mean, when I was a kid, my mother used to put mercurochrome on all scratches. Every time that me and my sister got a scratch, my mom would pull out that red, bright red bottle of mercurochrome and she'd smear it all over and it had this bright orangish red look, and then it would turn dark as it oxidizes, it gets dark. But yeah, mercurochrome, nothing like an amalgam of mercury and chromium to put into your bloodstream. Works wonders. Totally sanitary, kills all, it disinfects totally. In fact, works so well that it will disinfect your liver. Yep. So yeah, and that's only like in my lifetime. Okay, I did a post in the blog about this, but Free to Be, You and Me was aired 50 years ago this week, and it was a television special that I did not see on television, but it was a bigger hit with the kids, not on television, but in school, because Free to Be, You and Me was like, it was like the most popular film to show in elementary schools, and that's where I saw it many times, because usually every week there'd be one period, usually like the last hour on Friday, they would gather everybody in one room and they'd show a movie, and it would usually be like something science-y, or that's where I saw all kinds of really cool Bell Telephone films about electronics and chemistry. And the Bell Telephone films were just the most amazing and interesting. But Free to Be, You and Me was another one that they showed every year. I think I saw it every year through grade school. And I have a copy of Reel 1 on 16mm, which I transferred, and I put on my post that I tried to put it up on the YouTube channel, but it got slammed by my friends in Brazil. Second only to the UK for copyright slams on films, but there was a company in Brazil that claimed ownership of Free to Be, You and Me. So, you know, hello Marlo Thomas about Brazil claiming ownership of Free to Be, You and Me. But yeah, they slammed it big time, and it wasn't only like it can't be monetized. It was this will not be seen in all these countries. It was like blocked. It's like that's how bad it is. But unfortunate, because the film version that they showed in schools was different than the television version. It had the intro, outro was different, had different, you know, credits in every reel, and different title work and everything. So it was a different package, different edit and everything. So they packaged it differently for schools, and so it would have been cool to be able to show that. People were saying, "Fran, put it up on the Internet Archive." It's like, well, that's not the show. You know, Fran's film archive is here on my channel, but anyway, I tried. was a good one. I remember that one.